गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर गीतांशु। गुड
वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून मैम,
आफ्टरनून।
अ वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू वन एंड ऑल। आई एम डॉक्टर गीतांशु, कन्वीनर फॉर द आईआईसी ऑफ टीएमयू मुरादाबाद। आई एक्सटेंड अ वार्म वेलकम टू प्रोफेसर दीपाली कामथानिया, डॉक्टर मंजुला जैन, एसोसिएट डीन अकेडमिक्स टीएमयू एंड द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ द आईआईसी ऑफ टीएमयू एंड ऑल द पेट्रंस अटेंडिंग द सेशन। आई टेक इमेंस प्लेजर इन इंट्रोड्यूसिंग द वर्सेटाइल एंड मेरिटोरियस स्पीकर फॉर द डे, Professor Dipali Kamthania. She is Professor in School of Information Technology, VIPS, Delhi. Ma'am has more than 19 years of experience in academics and IT industry. Her areas of research interest include machine learning and hybrid PV systems. She has more than 80 research papers to her credit, which have been presented at national and international conferences and have been published in national and international journals. She has delivered many technical talks and chaired sessions at various academic forums. She also serves as an editorial board member for various reputed journals. She is a recipient of various awards: Best Paper Award in the year 2019-20, Best Teacher Award 2018 and 19, Active Participation Award in 2016-17 by Computer Society of India, Awards for Significant Contribution to the IT Field in 2013 and 14. We are extremely appreciative and thankful to ma'am for conducting this orientation session on innovation. Now I kindly request ma'am to commence the session.
Thank you, Dr. Gitanjali, and good afternoon to all the learned faculty members and beloved students who are present here. As ma'am told, I am Dr. Dipali, working as a professor in the School of Information Technology, Vivekananda Institute of Professional Studies. And it's my privilege for me that AICT has assigned me as the Innovation Ambassador. And I would like to thank Dr. Manjula Jain and Dr. Gitanshu Udawar and the management of TMU for giving me an opportunity to give the talk in the orientation session on innovation. So I would just like to share the PPT. So ma'am, have you given me the rights?
One second, ma'am. I'll just make you the host, ma'am. One second.
Yeah. It's done.
So I can share my screen?
Yes, ma'am. You can start sharing, ma'am.
Okay. Ma'am, is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay. So I would just like to start with the session. So the agenda for today's talk, we'll be just trying to understand the difference between the common term that is Jugaad and innovation. Then we will try to look at some of the visible and invisible innovation, and then discuss the innovation model, the ecosystem, and how our government is actually supporting innovation at different level, at the national level, regional level, the institute level, and how the institute play a major role to contribute to it. So I am sharing this screen with you, and I will just start with one of the phrases here, which is very common. We say that India is known as a land of Jugaads. So you can see a lot of Jugaads that are available on my screen. And in every walk of life, whether it's a village or a city, for every problem, we have the local solutions. We call Jugaad. But today, what we have gathered here for an orientation program on innovation of TMU, and we have our future engineers and entrepreneurs who will be developing among you. So first, I would like to make my point clear in your mind, the difference between the Jugaad and the innovation. And from the image of a Jugaad society, we have a long way to go to an innovative society. So first, let us understand the difference between these two terms. So Jugaad is basically, as you can see from all these images, it is basically a temporary solution with already available or discarded item to solve a problem, and basically it is a kind of temporary solution, or it is temporary in nature. Why? On the other hand, when we talk about the innovation, innovation basically works for the betterment of society, and its ultimate aim is to produce the product on the large scale and involve innovation so that it can have the commercialization to the large scale. So basically, if I say now, what is an innovation? So I can call it as a process in which engineers, doctors, entrepreneurs, they work on the existing problem to give a solution so as to improve the quality of life for the coming generation. It is basically a systematic approach to handle the existing problem and produce a viable solution for the large scale. Like you can take an example of Thomas Alva Edison for inventing the bulb and electricity. Similarly, Ford for inventing the car. Wright Brothers for inventing the aeroplane. Now, another question that comes to your mind or should come to your mind is, what is the difference between the innovation and discovery? Can we have anyone? Ma'am, have you given the rights? Can a student interact? Ma'am, can students interact? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Okay, can a student interact, or I'll just continue?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I just wanted to make a point here, the difference between the innovation and a discovery. Now, discovery is something which is already existing, right? You find it, you search it, you get it, and you call it discovery. Like just in day to day, you hear that astronaut has discovered a new galaxy, a star, an animal in a sea. And right now we can say that a new virus. So basically, innovation talk about the existing problems and the innovative ideas, which will result in making a new product, a process, a system, so as to improve the quality of life of society and mass in generations to come. So I hope we are clear with the difference between the jugaad and the innovation. Now, let's talk from another perspective now. We'll try to explore that, can India become, now as we said, we are known as a society of jugaad, and we have a long way to go to a innovative society. And now with this perspective, can we become a global hub for innovation? Like over last few decades, if you see, India has become the global hub for software development, offshoring to back office services. And now today, what we want to understand that the huge industry of this back office services and the software development that has started, now can we just become the innovative kind of society, or can it become a global hub, India become a global hub for innovation? Now, these offshoring and back office services, they have taken a flight of white collar job from developed world to India. When this is combined with the loss of manufacturing job to China, it has to led that how considerable angst among the Western population. In fact, if you look at the polls, you will find that there is a declining trend to support the free trade in the Western country. And the Western elites would, however, they have said that this fear is misspelled. So here, I would like to quote one famous author here, Thomas Friedson. He said, the world is flat in his book. Now, basically what he said that, what he was trying to put forward, the fear for free trade is wrong because it is based on a mistaken assumption that everything that can be invented has already been invented. In fact, he said that innovation that will keep the West ahead of developing world among the more sophisticated innovative tasks being developed in the developed world and the less sophisticated being developed in the developing countries. or in the developing world. Now, what are we trying to understand? Is this true that all the sophisticated jobs will be related to the developed world, and whereas the less sophisticated task will be done in the developing world? Let's try to understand this. And with this perspective, we'll try to understand that could India become the global hub of innovation, just like a global hub we have for back office services and software development. Now, if you ask the people who are supporting the Western innovation model, they will say, where are Indian Googles? Where is Indian iPod? And if Indians are so smart, then where are these innovation? So in order to support this, I would like to discuss today one of the is a research that has been carried out by Professor Nirmalaya Kumar, a professor at London School of Business. In his study, he asked many people there, and he said that would India go for being a favored destination for software services back and back office for innovation? Like, we already know that we have a lot of caliber and we have a lot of support for software development and back office services. But now what we are trying to ask, could India go for innovation? So what most of the people would say that India has nothing to do with the innovation. The most sophisticated one would have said, well, you know that India makes good software product programs and accountants, but they don't create creative stuffs. And, you know, some would say that, you know, it has nothing to do with India. It is really a rule-based regiment education system that is responsible for killing creativity. Now, so to further move on, we'll try to have a look at some of the companies like Google, Microsoft, Intel. And if you look that these companies, they have their R&D center and they have their innovation labs. And in most of the cases, if you will, you will find that these innovation centers and this innovation R&D labs, they are being headed by the Indians. So now the second questions again come that are these Indians educated coming out of the Indian education system? Now further study says, now the all those maximum number of people that we are trying to talk about, they came out of the Indian education system. So now, can India be based out of India, do innovative work? So what we are trying to say, like if we are trying to say that, now we are trying to put another thing here. Can Indians based out of India do innovative works, right? So what we see, now if we look at the different centers that you have across your Bangalore, Mumbai, Gurgaon, now all these centers, what is happening here, the level of corporate in these cities that you have. Now, when again the question is asked, now where are the Google Indian, you have the iPods and all. Now, where I am trying to take you forward is when we look at the innovation, we look only from one perspective, and which is innovation for the end user. Now, innovation is not only the innovation which is for the end user. The innovation for the end user is basically the visible innovation. And we cannot always talk about the visible innovation. When we talk about the visible innovation, you all have a lot to see about the Google products, about the iPods, the Apple, and so many innovation that we can talk of. There is a lot that is being done at the Indian end when we talk in terms of the invisible innovation. So we try to look at the innovation and from the point of view of a very famous economist, which we call Joseph A. Schumpeter, he said, innovation is novelty in how the value is created and distributed. So now what I am trying to talk here, I am not just trying to talk about the innovation, which is innovation for the end user. I am trying to talk about the innovation, which is that is how it is created and how it is valued. Now, it could be a new product. It could be a service, but it could also be a way in which a new product is being produced, or it could just be a novel way of the organizing your firms and your industries. Now, once you take this perspective, you no longer restrict innovation to the beneficiaries, or we can say just to the end user. So with the broader perspective, the conceptualization of innovation, that what we found, India is well presented in innovation, but innovation that is being done is in India is basically in form, in many cases it is in form of your invisible innovation. So we'll just try to look first at the four type of invisible innovation that are coming out of India. And then we will try to see how our government is supporting us, what are the different ways in which we can have embed the innovation culture into our organizations. So the first thing, if you see, we talk about the innovation for business customer. Let's see how we are trying to say this is the first case for the invisible innovation. Now, in the last few decades, you can say that many of the multinational companies, they have opened more than 100 R&D centers in India, and they are employing over 50,000 professionals, right? And generally, what is the job of the local R&D center? The job of the local R&D center is basically to localize the products for the, if I say it is in India, then it will try to localize the product for the Indian market. But when these R&D centers, they are being opened up in India, these R&D centers, they are not working on the localizing of the product. They are basically working on the global products. Like if you talk about the companies like Microsoft, Google, Extrazen, XAL, General Electronics, Philips, all these, they have come up with the R&D centers in the India, and they are basically making the products which are to be filed in, to be marketed in your global market. So now the next question come here, that the people might feel the kind of R&D that is done in the US and the kind of R&D that is done being India, they are not at par. Now further to, in order to understand that, now, whenever we want to understand or we want to analyze the level of R&D that is being carried out, we try to look how many patents are being filed by the company we can say the US company and its subsidiary in India. Then studies have shown that the kind of patents that has been filed by the US and the Indian subsidiary, they are no less. But further, in order to understand the quality of the patent that are being filed, we try to understand how much forward citation rate is there. Now, forward citation rate is nothing, but it is when you talk about any of the product, you try to see that whenever the next stage is there, how many times that the future patent, the older one has been referred. So there was a kind of a similarity between the forward citations that are being done. So the first kind of innovation that India is already in it, that is the innovation that is coming out of India. It is innovation for the business customer. Now let us try to understand the second kind of invisible innovation that is coming out of India. The second one here is outsourcing innovation to Indian companies. So what many of the companies are doing, they are making contract with the Indian companies, and a major part of their product development for the global product, they are being done in the Indian centers, and then they are being put together and they are being sold to the entire world. Like, for example, we can say in case of pharma industries, a lot of molecules are being developed and the major part of the work is being sent to India. Similarly, if you remember the HCL Technologies, they have developed a critical mission system for Boeing 787 Dreamliner. The one of them was to avoid the collision in the sky, and another one was to allow landing in zero visibility. But of course, when you get into the Boeing 787, you are not going to know that this is the invisible innovation that is coming from India. At this point of time, if many of you are listening, then you might have in your mind that there was some kind of a failure that happened with the Boeing. But it doesn't mean that we will stop taking the risk or failures are going to put us back. So there are we need to do more and more testing. But what I am trying to tell you here, when you look at the innovation, you always look at the innovation from the point of view of the end user. Like you look at the product, you don't know what where actually that project has been done. So you just look, okay, you look at the logo or the brand that particular company has made that. Now, third kind of invisible innovation that comes out of India, it is the process innovation. Now, what do we mean by this process innovation is it is different from your product innovation. This process innovation is because of the injection of intelligence by the Indian firms. It is about how you create or manufacture a new product, but not a new product in itself. Like here, I would like to tell, like if you talk about the call centers, right? And most of the young people, they dream to work in the call centers, right? The educated ones, graduates and all, they are looking forward to work in the call centers. But when we talk about the call centers from the point of view of Western culture, it is basically a dead job and where you can say the high school drops out, they actually do. But when these hundreds or thousands of young ambitious kids in India, they join the call center, what happened? Very quickly, they get bored and they start innovating and start telling their bosses how this job can be done better. And out of this process innovation comes the product innovation, which is marketed to rest of the world. Now, what I want to say here is, now let's talk about the 24/7 customer traditional call centers, right? But now what these call centers are doing, they are basically developing the analytical tools to do predictive modeling. And before you actually pick up the phone, they are able to understand what is required. So all this happened, why? This happened because of the injection of intelligence into the process, which was considered for a long time as dead in the West. And the last kind of innovation that you have here is the invisible innovation that is coming out of India, what we call here as the management innovation. Now, again, it is not a new product or a process, but it is a new way of organizing work. And most significant management innovation come from India, invented by offshoring industry and what we call here as the global delivery model. Now, what do I mean by a global delivery model? Basically, it allows you to take the previously core located tasks that you have broken them into parts, send them around the world where the expertise and the cost structure, they already exist, specify the mean for integrating them. And without this, you could not have any other invisible innovation today. So if I am trying to say that if a product for the end user is visible tip of the iceberg, then India is well represented in the invisible, large submerged portion of the innovation iceberg. Now we have two core implications of this. One I call here as the sinking ladder. So again, I'll go back from the point where I started the conversation about the flight of jobs. Now, of course, we have said that there are a lot of multinational companies which decide to outsource the job to the R&D centers, which are located in India. And as we started by saying from the Tony Fairwood, who would have predicted that the less sophisticated job will be done in India. So it means the bottom rung of the ladder will be given to the India. Now what happens when you outsource the bottom rung of the ladder to India for innovation and R&D work? At some stage in future, you need to confront a problem, which is the next ladder step need to come to India within the company. Now you have two choices. Now, either you bring the people from India to the developed world to take the new position. In the next step of ladder is the immigration, right? So you say the lot of people are already available in the bottom rung of the ladder who are waiting to take the opportunity. So why not move next step to India? So what are you trying to say here? That once you outsource the bottom rung, it is self-perpetuating act because of the sinking ladder. And sinking ladders simply point that you cannot be an investment banker without having an analyst one. So what you will do? So if you outsource the less sophisticated job or the bottom job in some point of time or the later stage, it is possible that the following step also need to come to the India. Now you need to do what? You need to do the browsing of the top management teams. If an R&D center is based out of India, and again the largest growth market are again coming out of India and China, then you have to confirm that top management of the future have to come from these countries. That is where it is important, market leadership. And India has the youngest growing population of the world. The demographic dividend is incredible, but paradoxically, there is also the migration of mighty labor pools. The Indian institutions, except for few exceptions, the educational system, they are not actually capable of producing the quality that is needed to keep this innovation engine going. So the companies are trying to find the innovative ways to overcome this. And it is also the government who is trying to create the educational system, and they have come up with your new educational policies. And a lot of initiatives has been taken by the Indian government, which we'll see in some time, to develop the innovation culture into the educational sector. Before I discuss the next point, I would just like to bring to your notice. Now, you all know that IBM is considered as one of the most innovative companies, and it is among the top 2-3 companies of the world who are filing the patents. But if I talk about the headcount of this country, and the data I have taken from 2009, because after that they have stopped disclosing the headcounts that are available in these companies. So in the 2009, out of the total employee, which is of 433,000, 98,000 employees are American and 150,000 employees are Indian. So I leave this question to you, that whether IBM is an American company or IBM is an Indian company. So these are the four invisible innovations that are enough to tell you that actually we are innovating. The only point is that when you look at the innovation, you look at the innovation from the perspective of the end user, but there are many other things that are involved in the innovation. And with respect to invisible innovation, India has a significant contribution. So now there is no more the question that whether we have to innovate or we don't have to innovate. The only question is how to innovate. Now, innovation is only possible when it is embedded. It is an educational sector, or it is any of the technological sector, any of the sector that we talk of. And we talk here of the innovation, one of the model innovation model here, which is visualized by a triangle, a square, and a pentagon. Now, what I'm trying to say here is, I'm trying to point out that a triangle here is representing what? The triangle here is representing the source of creativity element that is required to have any of the creative act. Here I talk about the three creative acts, like I say, with the talent, the energy, and the method. I am not trying to talk about someone with the exceptional gift in a specific area like Newton or Mozart. Now I'm just trying to discuss about you and me. Now, creative talent is what? It is just the skills by which we imagine new things and make them happen. And we all have these skills. What is required? We all need to work upon them to improve and develop them. Now, which requires what? Which requires energy. And energy here is again not in the Einsteinian sense. It is the energy and is simply the personal resource we devote to an issue. Like how much time and determination I am ready to devote to a particular topic that I have decided to go ahead.
So,
hello? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
I hope it is fine to all. Are you able to follow what I am saying?
Yes, ma'am, we are being able to follow. You're very much audible, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so what we are talking about the next thing. It means what is required. We say we all have the skill within us. What is required? We need to work more on our skill. We need to develop those skills within us, sharpen our skill. And for that, what is required? We need to devote the energy, which is our, in terms of the, I say, personal resource I am trying to talk, which is nothing but the determination and time. And now there has to be a formalized way to have to create, confront the challenges, explore, look for the solution. Now, all these things will lead to what? The alternating between the create thinking and critical thinking is what makes a creative and efficient solution to the things. So for all, I would basically say, I would just invite all those who are in the leadership position in your university to develop the pupil, to develop their talent, mobilize their energy. And you teach and practice the creative methods. Not teachers and students, they have to come together to do those things. So now what we say, we have the next part of this model here, that is a square. Now, square is represent what? It requires an individual, a team, a system, and the target. Now, in any of the institution, right, we have many of the students, or we say employees here, who are actually very creative. The individuals, they are actually creative. So what is required? It is the job of the teachers or the mentors there to bring those creative, or the people who are passionate about their work, you need to bring them together. You need to make them a team. You need to give them the challenges. Provide them the system, the environment. Now, again, when you form a team, the team can be, again, I'll say it could be a good team, bad team, and innovative team. Now, what I am trying to say here, good team means all the people who are connected, they all are very clear about their targets, we can say, and they are in good relationship with each other. And they come together for a particular task, they complete it and they move apart, right? But again, there's a bad team. Now, everyone in that team, there are a lot of egos, a lot of issues are going, they are not in the good relationship. They come together for the work, then part of away. Now, that's not going to lead to something that is be very positive. But again, there could be innovative team. The people who are clear with their thoughts, they want to invent the new ways of inventing things. They want to reinvent themselves. They are ready to work in teams, or they are ready to be the team players or the individual players. So those kind of students, they need to be brought together and they need to be given some kind of challenges. Now, when they innovate, now innovation, again, their targets, they can be different type of innovations, right? Something we say the radical kind of innovation that is there, like in 80s, we have the PCs, in 90s, we have the mobiles. Or it could be something, the innovation, just like innovation when you say just a new way of existing a business operates. Like as we have now the online shopping here, or we can say the way the Pepperfry, the home centers, they are trying to make the furnitures. It is not that something new they have invented. It is just the way has changed. Similarly, the banks, they are still, they don't invent the banking. They have done something like microcrediting they have done. So these are the small and continuous kind of changes that are taking place. Or like every day you see that one or the other company is coming up with a new model, Toyota, the Honda, they come up with a new model. So like the targets or the innovation can again be in different terms, like coming up with exactly a new model, just changing the way already existing system is there, just change the way the business operates. You can just very lively see the how familiar now we are with the online shopping. Previously, before Flipkart, if we see, we were not very comfortable, but Flipkart has set the base for the online shopping. And now that base has been further, actually, we can say that actually being utilized by Amazon and all. So like this, that was also one of the very innovative steps that was taken. Now, next, what it requires? It requires system. Now, you need to have a system to deliver these innovative targets. An organization need to collect, evaluate, and implement these ideas. Now, which can again be done in different possible ways, like there should be staff suggestion schemes, there should be student suggestion scheme, there should be the creative problem solving groups, simply giving time people to work on the new idea, solitary idea time, or the team time. You know, unless and until the student or the faculties are given the time, it is not possible to innovate. We may say that within the constraint also, the innovation will take place. But if we actually see, you need to have time. If you, the faculty or the students are always so busy in just giving the lectures or prepare, doing some kind of admin task, then, or students are always busy with the classes, then I think there need to be some kind of freedom that has to come. Some time need to be given for the pupil. Actually, a space is required to actually do that innovation part. So like, it's a challenge for all the organization to define their system and what actually is appropriate for them so that you can establish a structure for innovation, offer meaningful work and innovative teamwork, clearly define the innovation target and implement the system to achieve those targets. The next part in this innovation model here is ideas, freedom, engagement, humor, risk. So next, what the Pentagon represent here, it is representing here the culture, the behavior, norms and values in which innovation thrives. And you say ideas are something very important. This is what I said. Idea can come within a very crunch of time, or you can say without a freedom, we can say in a very restricted environment, it is there. But generally what is said, if you talk about the innovative institution, they really have a minimum rule book. They are open and they are empowering. They are free debates. It is allowed to disagree with your mentors, your teachers, your bosses. And the people who come up with a different perspective or something new, they are very well accepted, right? The students need to be engaged. Their energy need to be channelized. And humor is also required. We cannot be very strict. No, you have to do that. Give them liberty. Give them if a teacher has or a mentor has some point of view and a student have different point of view, let them take risk. Because unless and until there is a risk, or you can say failure is good for innovation. Like in your innovative organization must reward or even celebrate the failure. It is not punishable. You know, it's a success celebrate and not should only be celebrated. Now, together, what I am trying to put forward here is all these things together, like talent is there. We all need to do what? We just need to work more on our talent, right? We need to have determination. We need to devote time, right? Work as a team or work as an individual. Set your targets. The educational institution should provide a system. They should liberate ideas, give students and faculty freedom, allow them some humor. Don't say that if you have given 1 hour for some kind of discussion and students are having the humor there. No, that should be restricted, but you have to give them the liberty, because that is also a way to come up with the new ideas and let them take the risk, whether it's a faculty or it's the student. So when you synthesize all these together, the 12 innovation drivers, I must say, that is what actually help you in embedding from where we started, the innovation in the DNA of any of the organization. I hope you are able to understand what I am trying to put forward to you. Am I clear to all?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so next what we are trying to talk about, so we know that we have the 12 elements here, and next what we will try to see here is, now for any of the idea, basically what we have here, these steps here, which we say that there are any of the design thinking process involved where the five stages. The five stages here are empathize, define, ideate, prototype, and test. Now, what do I mean by that? Now, you have any of the idea, discuss it with your teachers, discuss it with your mentors, have a brainstorming session on that. And after that, after this empathy, you try to define, have a problem statement. Then after the problem statement, you have to now think out of the box. You have to ideate here, design a prototype for it, test it. Now, again, on the basis of the test, if you are failing, having some of the problem, again, just go back. So what we are trying to say, it is a kind of an iterative process. Test your product, put it on different kind of testing. Then finally, you come up with the prototype. And now why I have shown you this model, this is that from two point of view, I'm trying to tell you that if you know that your institute is already having this IIC cell, and your government has already floated so many policies to promote the innovation culture in the different organization. And there you have your hackathon, ideathon, strikeathon. So whenever you are had, students should participate in that. That is a very good platform for the students here. And in that prototype, you need to develop there what you need to submit your prototype there. So for first what they ask you to submit your ideas. Once your idea get approved, they ask you to say, submit your prototype. And then finally, you are moved to the next. If your idea is selected and your prototype is accepted, then they will allot you the mentors from the different institution or maybe from a different state. Then you will be pushed to the next level, that is your national level. And finally, if your product get accepted, you will get the funds for your startup. So you all need to understand that first think upon a problem, try to have a statement for it. Then based on whatever brainstorming section, try to come out with something new or not. Now new again is not in terms of the end user. It could be a process, it could be a service, or it could be a product here. Develop a prototype and then try to test it. Okay. Now why I said that? Now I said that your government is doing a lot. This is what I'm trying to show you. Just you have your current state here, right? So I want you, just you are sitting with some amount of money here and then you are dreaming, like desired, you want to have a lot of money, you want to travel all around the world, have a lot of luxuries. So what do you need to do? You need to first see it, believe it, and then what the most important thing that you need to do, you need to actually act upon it. And as said by your PM, take up an idea, make that one idea your life. Think of it, dream of it, live on that idea. Let the brain muscles and nerve be a part of your body full of that idea. Just leave every other thing alone. This is the way to success. Now, if you try to put all the 12 elements of innovation that I was trying to talk, you can see all those things will come together when actually you want to innovate. Otherwise, you can just sit, just listen to what all is going on and then just leave it. So let's see what initiatives Indian government is taking, how it is trying to promote the innovation or the ecosystem that it is trying to develop. Now, I'm just trying to show you the ecosystem that you have for the innovation development. Now, all these things, they need to work together, right? So to promote innovation, the government has developed the National Innovation Council. And at the regional level, what you have your secretarial council or you have your regional council and experts. Now, whenever any of the project is there, you need what? You need funds for that. So you have banks, you have the venture capitalists who are trying to help you out for this. Again, there are different organizations like you have CIL, you have that is the Community Infrastructure Levy, you have FICCI, IMI and other associations who are ready to give you the grants here. You have CSIR and R&D centers which are ready to support you for this. Now with this, there are national innovation system which this is the ecosystem where the different organizations are providing to you. And here what is happening, this is the basically support the research grants and the technologies. What you have, we have different kind of aids that are available at different level, at the university level, even at the science and technical institute. You have your IPRs, different government policies are here. And if we see, we are already into this innovation, whether the visible innovation or the invisible innovation. There are number of patents that are being filed in India. There is a rise in the percentage of growth by 68% as compared to the other countries. But when we look in totality, still you see, though there is a rise in the patent, the number of patent that we are filing, but still if you look, there is we have a long way to go. Like we have a long way. If you see here, IITs combined, they are filing against some 557 patents. This is the latest I could gather from the internet, the number of patents that are being filed in the last year. So we have a long way. Look at the China, how many patents they are filing. So we have though there is an increase in the trend of the patents that we are filing, but we have a long way to go. Now, these are some, I'm just trying to show you some of the startups. As I said, the quality of innovation is judged from the patents that we filed and the number of forward citations we have. So we can see that gradually we are increasing in the patents that we are filing, but again with the long way to go. Now, Indian government has come up with a lot of initiatives, right? The startup seeds, they are giving you the seed funds. They have started with the Mudra Bank. The Atal Innovation Mission is there. And in case your IIC cell is active, then you must have seen that few days back again, the Tricathon, Hackathon, then Kapila Mission. Every time the government is just for the students, they have been floating lot of incentive and opportunities where the student can just submit their prototype. You can submit your ideas and this can help you in what? This can help you in just starting your startup. So what I am trying to say, you have the ideation workshop where we started with the five step. We say have a problem statement and solution development. Your institute can conduct various workshop in order to involve this culture. Then any of the first, if you have an ideation, that workshop, you have your problem statement. With the problem statement, we go to the next step. We say development of proof of concept, which was the step that we talk about, the design thinking process. Then you would need to do what? Selection. Now government is doing what? You submit your idea, you submit your prototype, you have the selection of the best product. Now, once you have the best, again, you have the demo, your presentations. Again, they are providing you with the opportunity for the identify the components. Again, the workshops can be conducted. See, both the roles are here. How the institute can provide all these things like workshop on different type of workshops on seminar. Similarly, it is also showing you the process where the government is facilitating you by submitting the prototype, getting selection of the best prototype. Then this NEP prototype, now nominate best prototype on IIC portal. So what we are having today, we are having a talk from the IIC section only. So right, you students need to submit, identify your problem identification and make a problem statement, develop a prototype, then submit your prototype. Best prototype will be selected. The best prototype will be moved to the next level, the regional mentoring session. Then with the help of the boot camps and exhibition, venture planning, you can have the national levels. It can help you towards your own startup. And then finally, what we are saying, the government with lot many policies that we are trying to talk about here, the student can be the new entrepreneurs can be developed here. So if I put all these things together, this is what I was trying to say. There has to be a culture of innovation in an organization, in an institution, educational institution, which need to provide the environment by giving them time, by giving them resources, giving them infrastructure, giving them talks, resources, interaction with the industry member, industry people, the kind of quality education that is coming, the standards of quality need to be improved. There has to be more practical oriented. The kind of lectures need to be there. Teachers and students, they need to come together. And finally, what we will have an innovative institution or an innovative society here. Now, what your institution can do, again, a list, improved learning management system, new degrees, allowing you with the faculties, art books, and a lot of tuitions, virtual realities, and many other kind of things that can be supported by your organization. Now, these are some of the resources from which we have taken. So we have done from my side. Thank you, everyone.